Welcome to In It to Win It. This is Steve Barton, and thank you for tuning in. Today we have the man, the myth, the legend, Rick Rule. We are going to talk about coal, oil, uranium, the metals, and some recent policy changes by our favorite big thinkers. Rick, thank you for coming back on the show.
Steve, always a pleasure. Thank you for causing this to occur.
Yes, yes. Pleasure's all on this side of the table, sir. I gotta say, I am super excited. We have your next boot camp coming up. It's gonna be January 6th. And if you cannot make that day, do not fret. It will be available to watch as many times as you like over the next year. And the topic is development stage and pre-production mining. And as a serial attendee, I'm looking forward to this one. What can we expect for this boot camp?
Well, for those of your audience who've attended our prior boot camps, they understand something about the boot camp format. We give you 8.5 hours of programming on one topic. We've done uranium, we've done silver, we've done royalty and streaming. We try and give you enough information in 8.5 hours that you know how to ask the questions to allocate your portfolio in those areas. In other words, we really focus on investor education. We will do the same now with development stage companies. I consider the development stage, let me back up. The development stage is described as the boring phase in the Lassonde curve, when the press releases go away from tonnage and grade, and you're talking about securing permits, you're talking about how many yards of concrete you've poured, the stuff that absolutely drives speculators crazy in a negative sense. The consequence of that is that it is probably the most undervalued sector relative to risk in mining. But you have to understand how money is made in the sector. It is not uncommon when a company goes through the boring phase and attains on time, on budget completion. If they do at nameplate capacity, it's not unusual for the stocks to double. It's not unusual for companies to be taken over at that junction once they've been de-risked. So understanding how value is created, understanding how the process works, understanding the correct intelligent financial stack is critical to, I would say, participating in a sector that right now is, from my point of view, the most undervalued part of the value creation chain in mining. As with all of our boot camps, we will give you more information in 8.5 hours than you can absorb. So it's important that you play back the tapes, that you go to the website and play back the boot camp several times. I put on the uranium boot camp myself. I was the producer. I've now watched it 4 times, even having presented it. So it's important that people do that. It's important to note, too, that this will cost you $99 to attend, and there is an absolute gold-plated money-back guarantee. The financial risk is mine. The time risk is yours. You will get out of it what you put into it.
Awesome. We are looking forward to it. Now, when you talk about the Lassonde curve, you're basically saying there's a lot of hype and excitement when they're exploring, and then they actually have to build this thing, which can take years. And typically investors get bored and they start selling off. Mm-hmm. And then you're talking about the sweet spot right down here, kind of like Silvercrest went through 6 months or a year ago, right?
And Silvercrest is a great example. They completed that mine on time, on budget, but not at nameplate capacity. So it's important that you understand how to measure the news and how to track progress. Silvercrest is a wonderful example. But what you say is true. The front end of the Lassonde curve after a discovery is the province of retail investors, high net worth family offices, and specialist funds. The really big money, the mutual funds and the generalist investors, the institutional investors, come into a company after they've attained nameplate capacity. There is an arbitrage between the point in time when the retail investors are getting bored and the big money is getting interested, where although the risk is declining substantially, the share price often declines too. And it's precisely taking advantage of that anomaly, the handoff from the individual investor to the mutual fund and institutional investor, that we'll be discussing in the developers bootcamp.
Nice. I look forward to it. There will be a link down in the show notes below. If you're going to go support the show, use the link. Rick's been nice enough to kick a little bit back to the show. It's the same cost to you, and you get to support your favorite podcast in the process. So we hope to see you there. Okay, we've got some recent news. The Federal Reserve just had their last meeting. They said they're going to continue to pause, and they expect that they're going to have 3 rate cuts next year. I'm going to share my screen here real quick and just take a look at how markets reacted to this. So the S&P 500 shot up literally on the hour while he was talking. The dollar fell precipitously. The Dow hit a new all-time high. Gold went from 2,000 to north of that, and silver had a similar move. And then what I thought was interesting down here, if we look at the 2-year yield, went down, so did the 10-year and the 20 and the 30. What do you make of this? Like, what is the market telling us that it took with that information?
Well, the market's always reflective and reactive, and the market's reaction will change over time. So a few comments to what you just said. When you say that the Dow hit an all-time high, that's in nominal dollar terms. It didn't in real dollar terms. And when people say that gold hit a new all-time high, it didn't. It hit a new all-time high in nominal value terms, not inflation-adjusted terms. So it's important to note that the real economic extent of the rally is likely overstated in the sense that we are using nominal rather than real values, which means that if the Fed is good to its word, that there's a lot of reaction to come, that the game isn't over. I would caution listeners from imputing too much near-term relevance to what they've seen. I've seen all kinds of social media presence about the fact that gold is now, you know, on the track to the stars, and silver isn't going to go through the roof, but it's going to go all the way to the moon. You know, ridiculous stuff like that. A few comments. First of all, the Fed has been known to lie. And I believe that Mr. Powell is more concerned about inflation than he lets on, given the fiscal irresponsibility of Congress. He's under extraordinary political pressure, but to the extent that he can jawbone lower interest rates without delivering them, to the extent that he can restore confidence to housing markets and bond markets without actually cutting rates, I think he would prefer to do that. Okay. I don't think he's going to be able to do that. I think he actually is going to have to cut rates. And if he cut rates, that'll do some interesting things. It'll provide immediate relief to the bond market. Rising interest rates kill long bonds. And the long bond market has been killed in a way that's very familiar to gold and silver speculators. Cutting rates will also do amazing things in the near term to the stock market. So the first thing that gold and silver investors need to understand is that while cutting rates will strengthen the case for gold and silver measurably, there will be competition for the marginal dollars. An example might be that a lower cost of capital really favors the technology business, which is a huge consumer of capital. So some of the speculative capital that we would have hoped went into the gold and silver market will almost certainly go into small and large tech. I think that's true. Looking longer term, however, I think it is important for gold and silver speculators to understand that real moves in precious metals prices occur as a consequence of a lack of faith in the maintenance of purchasing power in fiat currencies, as we've talked about so much. So let's look at the arithmetic one more time. Too many of your listeners conflate the CPI with inflation. The CPI is not a cost of living index. It's a constructed index. It's hedonistically adjusted, which means that the big thinkers decide what the actual value of your house or your apartment or your computer is. More problematically, the CPI does not include tax. When I do a thought experiment and I look at the value of my savings in U.S. dollar terms relative to the goods and services that I purchase, including those like government that I'm forced to purchase, what I learn is that the deterioration of my purchasing power is humming along at about 7% compounded, not 2.6. Here's the rub for gold or silver, gold and silver. If you believe, as I do, that the deterioration of the purchasing power of the U.S. dollar will continue unabated for a fairly long time, and your savings are now paying you 3.5% as a consequence of rate hikes, what that means is that you are being paid 3.5% in a currency that's depreciating by 7% compounded. This absolute guarantee that you will lose purchasing power will certainly diminish your confidence in the purchasing power, and I would suspect will help gold or silver. Listeners with a sense of history will perhaps remember back to the decade of the 1970s, where the lessons around inflation, the lessons around government spending, took 3 or 4 years to take hold. The popular culture didn't pay attention to the gold price at all in the move from $35 to $200. And in fact, after that move, when the Fed raised interest rates, the gold price fell in the middle part of that decade from $200 to $100. It wasn't until early 1976 where the Fed really blinked that gold really truly got on the horse and went from $100 to $850. The point of reciting this history is it would be a mistake for your listeners to believe that as a consequence of the Fed announcing its intention to pivot, that the gold price, the silver price, and the prices of gold and silver equities immediately skyrocketed, or to believe that all of the money, which might logically be expected to come into gold and silver, will. There has been 40 years of experience, which suggests that the best domicile for capital in a market like this is technology, and it will certainly siphon off some of the speculative capital around gold or silver. That notwithstanding, I continue to own gold, not because I think that the Fed's action might take the price from $2,000 to $2,400, but rather because of the ongoing deterioration of the U.S. dollar. I think perhaps taking the gold price to $8,000 or $9,000 or $10,000. Is it going to happen? I don't know. Is it going to happen soon? Almost definitely not. Is it a contingency worth insuring against? Absolutely, positively, but be patient. Don't expect that your dreams of avarice are going to be fulfilled in calendar 2024.
Okay. So what you're saying is that in nominal terms, it went up. So as far as the number value, but it's because the value of those units, the dollars,
correct,
became less. So it takes more of those units to purchase the same thing, whether it's a barrel of oil or an ounce of gold.
Correct.
Okay. Correct. Okay.
And I'm telling people that they're in the right place with gold or silver. It's just I've noticed with particularly many of the newer investors in the space that the time frames that they assign themselves are insufficient to enjoy the benefits that I believe are inevitable.
Okay. Okay. And you could see some of that rotating into technology as kind of a last little.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay, first question from AJB, and this was the most popular one. There was a lot of guesses as to what your answer will be. I have my own. If Rick could hold just one precious metal stock and one diversified metal stock for the next two decades, which would they be?
This is a timely question. Understand that I am now more of an investor than a speculator. For me, with a 40% decline in the share price of Franco-Nevada, I would own Franco-Nevada. The stock fell by 40%, because they have lost, at least temporarily, an asset that was 15% of net asset value. So if I had to pick one, and by the way, I would never be constrained, but as a thought exercise, it would certainly be Franco-Nevada. If I had to buy one diversified miner, well, there's two answers to that. If I had to buy one diversified miner on behalf of other people, that is risk adjusted, I would buy BHP. If I had to buy it for my own account, I would buy Glencore.
Mm.
Glencore has a lot of political risk around the fact that they got caught doing what everybody else has done, which is to say bribe governments. But Glencore has overemphasized coal, which is really flowing through their balance sheet and their income statement. BHP is certainly lower risk. The iron business that they have at the Pilbara will be a very good business for a very, very, very long time. But as I say, I personally would take a bit more risk and I would go to Glencore as opposed to BHP. So it really depends on if you're asking me what I would do with other people's money or what I would do with my own.
Interesting. Okay, those were my guesses, Franco-Nevada and BHP. I did not expect you to say Glencore. I thought Glencore might be a little pricey right now, but you're saying it's not.
I don't think Glencore is pricey. I think Glencore exposes you to well above average political risk.
Okay. All right. Interesting. You know, while we're on the subject of Franco-Nevada, I was going to bring that up later, but since you did, this is a true opportunity, correct? I spent a couple of days, and let me give a shout out to your Rural Classroom. You had some top-notch content on that with yourself and with Adrian Day. And this is a scenario, if I'm not mistaken, where, like you said, it's dropped 40%, but that value, you know, that they lost was 15 or 16%. And on top of that, there is a real case that this mine could come back online, correct?
I absolutely think so. If the Panamanian voters are numerate, that's a big if, of course, the Panamanian voters will look at a few facts. First of all, this mine by itself is 5% of Panamanian GDP, and the mine's output was slated to double. Mm-hmm. The fiscal contribution of the mine to the Panamanian government by contract over the next 10 years would be $385 million a year, the largest source of income for the Panamanian government by a wide margin. That $385 million a year has now gone to money heaven. And the Panamanian government signed a contract subject to international arbitration with First Quantum and First Majestic. What that means is that these companies have a call on arbitration against the Panamanian government for a tidy little sum, $10 billion, which is around $7 billion more than the Panamanian government has. So if there was a default judgment, which if the international courts observe the rule of law, there would be, the Panamanian government would be effectively bankrupt. They would give up $385 million a year in revenue into the treasury to spend the way that the electorate, or at least the politicians, dictated. And they would restore 5% of the national GDP. This decision on the part of these voters, well, I guess it's applicable. And understandable. If you look at the way that that Americans vote, why should the Panamanians be any smarter than we are? But I think that Panama has less room to make mistakes than we do. When we make a mistake, we can print our mistake away, or we can, at the very least, put it on a bond and sell it to some unassuming foreigner. The Panamanians don't have the ability to make mistakes of this quantum.
Yeah, they're going to have to pay the piper or reopen the mine and collect money.
Correct.
Okay.
Or face a really, really, really ugly judgment.
Yeah, yeah. You know, and that one's going to take place, I think, in Miami if it ever gets to that, right?
Yeah, I mean, it'll take a while. It'll take 2 or 3 years. But if you're talking about an investment in Franco-Nevada, which theoretically pays out over 10 years, while 3 years might not correspond with the time frame that you would prefer, it's a realistic time frame in terms of investment. If you look at the fact that the market has priced in a total loss of 15% of net present value and responded to it with a 40% decline in the share price without factoring in any possibility of recovery, I would say that the probability is that there will be some form of recovery. In fact, I would say that the probability is that there is a negotiated settlement between the parties, but only a probability, not a certainty. I think that there's a probability that there's some form of recovery.
Okay. That's good news. Yeah, we doubled our position in Franco-Nevada, and then And my parents' account, we did the same. My brother did the same, and in the missus' account. So we're taking right. advantage of this.
And I've done the same in the Rick Rule managed accounts. So
Nice. Okay, moving on to coal. One of our members, Nolan, suggested that we take a deep dive into coal. And so we did. That led us to getting Matt Warder on the show. And I believe that man has forgotten more about coal than we will ever know. If you haven't seen the link, then we'll put a link right up here so you can watch it. What work did you do with Matt in the past? You guys had a newsletter?
I provided some investment selection to an investment newsletter that Agora published that Matt was the co-author of. Matt and his partner, to be fairly honest with you, went fairly far beyond their range of expertise. These guys are coal and iron guys, and the nature of my investment picks were probably 10% around coal. My iron picks didn't require very much deep dive. They were Rio Tinto and BHP. So they were trying to bulk out their consultancy by editing a newsletter where I was responsible for the investment selection. They were responsible for the trading strategies.
Okay.
But Matt's real expertise is domestic, which is to say US-based coal.
Okay. What is your opinion on Teck being taken over by Glencore?
If you're referring to the transaction by which Teck sells their coal interest to Glencore, I think, sadly, it's in the interest of Teck shareholders. They are selling a world-class operation. An operation which is uniquely benefited by virtue of the fact that it's Canadian coal. Many coal purchasers worldwide want political diversification in terms of their sources of supply. And they are selling this at a very, very, very good price. By good, I mean good for the buyer. So this benefits Glencore. Glencore will take this asset, combine it with their own coal assets, and spin this off into public markets as perhaps the best pure coal play in the world. At the same time, despite the fact that Teck is selling this at a price that I think is more advantageous to the new shareholders than the old shareholders, they will realize value from a coal unit that capital markets hadn't assigned very much value to at all. And additionally, given the odd political reality in Canada and the rest of the world, selling this great unit will lower Teck's cost of capital because they won't be regarded as a coal company anymore. They will be an energy transition materials company. Rather than being involved with the demon cash-generating coal, they'll be involved in the zinc business and the copper business. So they will become viewed in the eyes of the big thinkers as good guys, as opposed to bad guys. The political reality is that an economically challenged transaction will work out for the better for both the acquirer and the seller.
Okay. All right. A win-win, you'd say?
Absolutely a win-win.
Okay. All right. What is your... Matt mentioned that he thought met coal might have a better upside in the coming years than thermal coal. Do you see the same thing? Or...
Not necessarily. I think that met coal has more political cover. When people look at the coal business, they can justify met coal because they use steel. When people in the United States and Canada and Western Europe, with the exception of Germany, look at thermal coal, that's a polluting substance that Chinese and Indian people use. It's bad. It's foul. So I think Matt verges, unfortunately, on being politically correct with that statement. The world is building thermal coal plants like mad. And when Western big thinkers fly 1,000 private jets to Davos to tell, or Dubai, to tell you and I to drive less, people in frontier and emerging markets have a very different point of view. People in those markets believe that you should measure carbon output per capita, not by country. And Chinese people and Indian people and Indonesian people and Brazilian people use much less carbon than we do per capita. Those countries also believe that you should measure carbon output historically, which is to say the existing carbon loadings in the atmosphere need to be taken into account. If we're going to have real carbon justice on a worldwide basis, your gasoline is going to $25 a gallon, and your electricity in your home in the United States and Canada is going to go to 80 cents a kilowatt hour, which means that you are going to call your congressman and say, screw green, I want my current lifestyle. Which is to say that despite our protestations to the contrary, we aren't going to get in the way of Indian coal consumption or Chinese coal consumption, because to do so would quintuple our energy costs, just like they have in West Germany.
Okay.
That's just a hard dose of political reality.
Yeah. Yeah. And that would, if we do end up having a recession, that would make sense, because we're going to be using less steel to manufacture stuff, but we're still going to need electricity.
What I'm trying to say is that demand for coal for steel making is going to increase, and demand for coal for power generation is going to increase. The political cover around steel making is greater than the political cover around energy, because cynical Western people use steel and they generate their electricity other ways.
Okay. That makes sense.
It's total hypocrisy.
Yeah.
Hypocrisy is common.
Yes. Okay. He also mentioned natural resource partners. That I didn't know there was a royalty play on coal, but what do you think of that company?
NRP, I'm more neutral about. It has been priced more as a yield play than as a coal play. The consequence of that is that if we were to see, which I don't think we will, increasing interest rates, you'll see two challenges for NRP. One will be that the capitalized value of their distributions fall at the same time that their cost of capital, debt capital, increases. So I would describe myself as neutral on NRP. And by the way, they're not just coal royalties. They're also involved in aggregates and other industrial materials.
Okay. Okay. You're saying it's more of like a dividend play.
Correct.
Okay. All right. Moving on to oil. We got a neat comment here from Pete. He says, thank you for all the great content you and Rick put out. It literally changed my life and perspective on extracting industries. So I thought that was pretty cool.
I hope it improves his bank account.
Yes, I do as well. All right. He's got a question here on oil. Exxon, Chevron, Occidental. How would you rank those if you had to? And what ranking would you give them?
In that same order, Exxon, Chevron, Occidental.
Okay.
Occidental has the most torque to oil prices. So as oil prices go high, the biggest beneficiary is Occidental. But Exxon and Chevron are truly integrated companies. They make money, ironically, when the oil price falls, too, because the feedstock that goes into their refining and marketing operations falls. They make money when oil prices rise because they're big upstream producers. These are wonderful, wonderful, wonderful businesses. They are priced in a way that suggests, at least where the big thinkers suggest, that peak oil demand occurs in 2032. They're assigned no net present value for cash flows that they achieve after 2032. I believe that peak oil demand occurs in 2065. So I'm assigning them lots of continued value. In Exxon in particular, you get the best capital allocator in the oil and gas industry. You get a company that disagrees with President Biden's forecast as to peak oil demand, and they disagree by paying $60 billion to increase their domestic production with Pioneer. You also get a company that is a real leader in the technology around horizontal drilling. Pioneer was able to drill sort of 1 mile or mile and a half laterals. Exxon is able to drill 4 mile laterals. So combining the Pioneer acreage with the Exxon acreage, which basically interfingers, means that the extractive efficiency that Exxon will be able to achieve in the Permian Basin will be unrivaled in the basin by any competitor. In addition to that, Exxon has been involved in a series of frontier discoveries in Guyana, which now total 11 billion recoverable barrels. Part of the weakness in the Exxon stock has come from the fact that the tin pot dictator next door to Guyana this guy Maduro in Venezuela has decided that he's going to invade Guyana. What he might use for money, what he might use for troops and tanks, he hasn't disclosed. And I would suggest that in a fair fight between Venezuela on one side and Guyana, the United States, and Brazil on the other side, there would be a fairly quick conclusion. My suspicion is that this is political rhetoric, that Mr. Maduro has stolen everything possible to steal in Venezuela, and he's looking to extort other people or at least divert domestic political attention from his own failings. Suffice it to say, for investors, Exxon is really, really, really unparalleled. You will note that in addition to ramping up their domestic expenditure, one of the few oil companies which is spending enough by way of sustaining capital to meet to continue production, that they spent $60 billion increasing their opportunities in the Permian with the acquisition of Pioneer. They will spend more billions of dollars unlocking 11 billion barrels of recoverable crude in Venezuela at the same time that they've committed to increase their return to shareholders by 14% by way of increased dividends and increased buybacks. From an investment point of view, truly unique. Does that mean that it goes up in price in the next 3 months or 4 months or 5 months? I have no idea. But over the next 5 years, this will be a measurably stronger company, all the while paying you wonderful dividends while you wait. If I didn't have so many nice things to say about Exxon, I'd say that Chevron is a wonderful investment. Great refining and marketing capacity in the United States, where we haven't built a new refinery since 1974. It's arguable that petroleum demand has increased in the period 1974 to 2024. Great allocators of capital. They've expressed their own sense of where the oil market is going by entering into a transaction to acquire one of the oldest family-run firms in the United States, Hess Petroleum, which is involved in refining and marketing and upstream in the United States and also involved in Guyana. So I'm attracted to that one too. Occidental is much more a play on crude oil and natural gas in the United States. They, like the other two, recently have entered into a large transaction, their fourth in the last 20 years. This is Warren Buffett's favorite, at least as a percentage of his portfolio. Very, very, very leveraged to U.S. production, particularly in the Permian Basin. Do I like Exxon? Absolutely. Do I like Chevron? Yep. How about Occidental? Absolutely. In that order, from an investment perspective, Exxon, Chevron, Occidental.
Okay. And what are they on your rankings right now?
I'm trying to work up the courage to take Exxon up to a three, but I haven't done it. I have all three of them as fours currently.
Okay. That's it. I haven't tracked Occidental as far as its leverage to the crude oil price. So that might set up.
It has more of a challenged balance sheet than Exxon or Chevron. Some of that, of course, to Buffett's convertible. But I think that the leverage that they have to the crude price and the number of proved undeveloped locations that they enjoy in the Permian justifies the risk associated with that financial leverage.
Okay. Okay. Awesome. All right. Moving on to uranium. G-Man wants to know, maybe we could talk a little bit about the kind of the natural cycles of bull markets and commodities, where usually the commodity itself moves first, then the majors right. And the juniors, because he says uranium commodity is not coupled with the uranium equities. You know, maybe you can talk about that natural cycle.
I think it has. It may be that the gentleman owns too many penny dreadful uranium companies that don't have any uranium and rather are looking for it. One needs to bear in mind that if the price of a commodity that you don't have any of increases, it shouldn't impact your intrinsic value very much at all. The truth is, in the 3 years, Steve, that you and I have been talking about uranium, the uranium price has increased from about $15 to about $80. We spent more time talking about uranium in the $20 to $30 range, but we started talking about it in the $15 range. Now, it's important to note that the best measure of that, the spot uranium market, has done what we said. The surrogate for that, the Sprott Physical Uranium Trust, has basically kept pace. The shares of Cameco have increased at a lesser rate. They've gone from $8 to what, $45, $46? So part of what the gentleman says is true. The price of the uranium equities has not kept up with the uranium price, which is what we expect. The real decoupling has taken place in the wild end of the uranium juniors. There are about 80 companies who purport to be in the uranium business, which is to say juniors, probably 12 of which are viable at $80 uranium. The 68 uranium pretenders, the people who trade on the uranium narrative and a uranium thesis, rather than trading on uranium, mercifully have not kept pace. I would suggest because investors are starting to understand that these companies are looking for uranium rather than having uranium. Uranium is important to them only because it's a component in the name on the share certificate.
Okay. And we have some recent news on a bill that's making its way through our big thinkers, and it's passed in the House. It's on to the Senate, and we'll see if Sleepy Joe signs it. But it's on barring the imports of Russian uranium, and the Kremlin has responded to this. What is your take on this, and how
it's political grandstanding? Pardon this phrase, but it's total bullshit. Molecules are fungible. And if we decide not to import Russian uranium and Russian enriched uranium, two things will happen. Our price per pound will increase a buck or two per pound. And the uranium that we don't take, the Chinese and the United Arab Emirates and the Indians will take. And uranium from Australia and China, Australia and Canada, which currently goes to China, will come to the United States. That's what will happen. And that brain dead group of people in the U.S. Senate and the U.S. House will go home to their brain dead constituencies and say, we defended American interests by protecting ourselves against Russian molecules, who, of course, went to China. I mean, it's just utter stupidity.
Okay, so it may you're saying it's probably going to take the same course that gas did from Russia, and it's going to go to Belarus, and then Germany's going to pay a premium for to the
middle. That's right. Molecules are fungible. We've learned with regards to Russian hydrocarbons, countries don't have friends. Their leaders and elites have interest. So Russian oil goes to India, gets turned into gasoline, and that gasoline gets sold in Germany. Wonderful deal for the Indians. Now, yeah. I'm not trying to defend Russia's actions. I'm not doing anything like that. I'm talking about political reality. These molecules, this energy is fungible. It doesn't care who uses it. Finding a market in China and then having Canadian uranium displaced from China into the U.S. market will be the ultimate outcome. Now, these senators and congressmen will be able to go home over 4th of July and say, I was looking out for your interests. I was defending God, guns, gold, and America in Congress when they were doing nothing of the sort. They were drinking bourbon and exposing their stupidity. Sadly, in reverse order.
Okay. So do you see that there could be any premium, and maybe this would only be a perception because I think most people probably don't know what you just said. Maybe there's a premium put on companies like Uranium Energy Corporation simply because it's based in America?
There will absolutely be a premium on U.S. uranium because Americans are ethnocentric and stupid, just like people in other parts of the world. In addition, Sleepy Joe, as you describe him, has gone over 4 years from the point of view 4 years ago where he wanted to put guys like me out of business to the point where now he wants to subsidize us. The moron has decided that we are no longer the greatest enemies of humankind, but rather we are upstanding patriots who deserve to steal $4.6 billion from the American taxpayers to further our own private interests. While this embarrasses me, given that he steals as much as he possibly can from my right pocket, If he wants to slip a little bit into my left pocket, I guess I'll accept it. Yes, there will be a premium paid for American producers, both because American investors, like all other investors, are ethnocentric, and also because the U.S. Congress has decided to spend even more money that they don't have subsidizing American interests. While I'm embarrassed to be the recipient of stolen property, I understand it's a political reality.
Okay. So there will be a premium on that, and some of it has to do with the ironically named Inflation Reduction Act, and some of that is going to go to... Okay.
Correct.
All right. Okay, quick update for Adi Wong on Cameco. How do you see it? Overvalued, undervalued, fair priced?
Fair priced with an if. Cameco is part of the purchase of Westinghouse, and Cameco is trying to make the transition from uranium miner to full cycle uranium service provider, from exploration all the way through waste disposal, from nuclear reactor construction to nuclear reactor ownership and seller of electricity. If this works, this is a long ball home run. But understand that Cameco is no longer in one business. Cameco is in four or five businesses. Can they operate successfully in four or five businesses? I don't know the answer to that. In the near term, investor perception around Cameco is only going to get better. The $80 price, spot price for uranium, is actually understated in terms of its importance, because more and more transactions are taking place in the term market. And the term market gives Cameco and other big producers, there's only one other, visibility into the sales price that they'll receive for uranium for periods of time up to 15 years. This benefits Cameco because they have about 15 million pounds of production that's been shut in due to low prices. And they will be able to forward sell this material effectively through term markets to guarantee their shareholders a reasonable return on capital, rather than being subjected to the night-by-night fluctuation in the spot market. And this same certainty will be reflected in terms of the visibility of Cameco's future earnings. This is a really, truly virtuous circle. Separate and apart from my fears around their Westinghouse transaction, my hopes and their fears, it's very clear to me that increasing their production by 15 million pounds a year with built-in margins, and those margins guaranteed by credit-grade counterparties for 15 years, means that the uranium price truly will transform Cameco and will transform investors' opinions about it.
Okay. They're not just pulling this stuff out of the ground now. They're entering into like the whole fuel cycle.
And they haven't been pulling the stuff out of the ground because it's been too cheap. It's no longer too cheap, but much more importantly, they have visibility as to the price they'll be paid for it 5 years from now, 10 years from now, and 15 years from now, as opposed to being exposed to the vagaries of the spot market, which is an overnight market.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Moving on to precious metals from Lane. He's talking about First Majestic. Keith Neumeyer just said in an interview with Kitco that they will not reopen Jared Canyon for at least 2 years, maybe three. What? How do you view First Majestic right now?
I think that's an important statement by Keith. A lot of us, myself included, were afraid that Keith was going to pour $150 or $200 million into Jarrett Canyon, for better or for worse. And I think a realization that they need to do more exploration at Jarrett Canyon before they reopen it at this metals price is a very important realization. I've always liked the fact that Keith faces hard decisions head on. and so I applaud him for that. I think there's probably still some room for valuation downside in First Majestic, because First Majestic, at least a year and a half ago, was priced for success, which they were unable to deliver as a consequence of the Jarrett Canyon acquisition. It's nice to see the increase in free cash flow from operations like Hermitillo. And I think that you might see First Majestic be involved in another acquisition if you don't see the price of silver juniors begin to escalate fairly quickly. Despite the fact that the First Majestic share price has fallen, there are other companies that have either fallen more or been unrewarded for the progress that they have generated. And to the extent that the market doesn't recognize that, Keith will be the first to take advantage of it.
Okay. All right. Okay, I think we got to move on to the lightning round here. You ready?
Yep.
Okay. Aranya.
Don't know enough to comment.
Okay. West Red Lake.
West Red Lake is fully priced as to where they are now, but this has a lot of upside. This is backed by one of the best mining investors in history, Frank Gistra. They're operating, as the name suggests, in the Red Lake Belt in Ontario, which is one of the great, great, great gold producing areas in the world. They bought a very troubled mine called the Madsen from, among other people, Sprott as creditor. To the extent that they can spend the money drilling out Madsen and integrate that with the rest of their Red Lake operations, there's a lot of upside here. The markets recognize that upside. So don't believe that you're stealing the stock. What you believe in is that you are with a really, truly superior group of people who have acquired assets on the cheap in a superb area. Lots of upside here, but the upside is contingent on the drill bit.
Okay. Montage Gold.
I'm a shareholder of Montage Gold. I am delighted with their exploration progress. I still need the data to tie together, which is to say that I'm having a difficulty with the current data, building a pit, building a mine around it in my own mind, and I'd like to see some high-grade starters or feeders. This is a wonderful group of people backed by the Lundin family, who have been serially successful in exploration around the world, but in particular in Africa over the last 20 years. The same group of people took a grassroots discovery in Sudan, built it up, and sold it to Resolute. I think they have a reasonable chance of doing it again. I've talked a lot of times, Steve, on your show about choosing a team whose expertise is suited to the task at hand. These guys did it with Red Lake and Mauritania. They did it in Sudan. Now they're back again, their third trip. And importantly, they're backed by the same investors, the Lundin family, who have backed them in their three prior ventures.
What ranking do you have them?
I have them as a 5 right now. I like everything about it, except for I don't have enough data to make them a 4.
Okay. All right. Ivanhoe Electric and Ivanhoe Mines.
Ivanhoe Mines I still have as a 4, which is amazing. After a run to a $15 billion market cap, it's just that the news keeps outrunning the market. It's amazing with a $15 billion market cap that they can talk about the fact that over the next 4 years, their copper production from Kamoa-Kakula doubles. And that they have a copper discovery that's important enough that you could make a material difference to a $15 billion market cap company. And that they are going to put the highest grade zinc mine in the world into production in the next 2 years, which will also materially impact, by way of cash flow, a $15 billion market cap company, and that they are advancing to production the world's largest undeveloped platinum and palladium mine in South Africa. Risks? Well, South Africa is not a company, not a country. It's a disaster area. And Congo's a little worse, although Congo's, in fact, increasing. So there's lots of political risk. But it's fronted by the single finest mining entrepreneur of my generation, Robert Friedland. Disclosure, I'm not long. I'm way long this name. And I'm way long with an average price below a dollar. So at $12, to say I'm happy is an understatement. I'm ecstatic. It's worthy to note that Mr. Friedland doesn't consider the stock undervalued enough that he isn't willing to go to market to raise money. He's raising $500 million at $12 per share. That's because Robert Friedland doesn't want to be cut short. He has so much opportunity in front of him that he is willing to take the near-term dilution to build value over 4 or 5 years within the framework of an intelligently constructed balance sheet. Ivanhoe Electric is much more about promise. I'm long Ivanhoe Electric too, but it's difficult to put a valuation in place because you are attempting to value work that has yet to be done, both at Tintic in Utah and at Santa Cruz in Arizona. And you need to value, too, the technology, the Typhoon technology, which is a ground-penetrating radio or geophysical technology that is designed to help geoscientists see beneath the Earth's surface. If this works, and the proponents say it does work, this fundamentally changes the way exploration takes place worldwide. It's a truism that a geologist, or anybody else for that matter, can see about an angstrom into the Earth's surface, which means that almost every discovery that's ever been made has literally been tripped over by a geologist. They have to outcrop. The ability to impart large amounts of electrical energy into the Earth's crust and look at the chargeability anomalies accurately and process these based on artificial intelligence and take a look at deposits that are a mile deep has the potential to be earth-changing. Will it work? That's a different question.
Okay. Arizona Metals.
I am warming up to Arizona Metals, although I think the market cap of Arizona Metals is very full.
Okay. Last one, New Stratus Energy.
I know nothing about New Stratus Energy.
Okay. All right. Well, awesome. Thank you very much, Rick Rule. Do you have any closing thoughts? Any final words?
Well, of course, I do this to popularize Rule Investment Media, a for-free education service. Bring your natural resource portfolio to Rule Investment Media, list it, and I'll rank it. Please no tech stocks, please no crypto, please no pot stocks. And then check out the Rule Classroom, where there's 200 hours of programming around how to invest in natural resource and precious metals and energy stocks. Use the information that you get from the Rule Classroom to attend the Rule Boot Camps and the Rule Symposiums. These are wonderful value for money products. They are best used in conjunction with a prepared mind, and you prepare your mind at the Rule Classroom. $99 for the boot camp, gold-plated money-back guarantee. If I don't deliver $99 in value, I give you your money back. Look, too, at coming to the Boca Raton Investment Symposium. I would suggest the finest natural resources investment symposium on the planet. Once again, full money-back guarantee. This occurs in mid-July in Boca Raton, Florida.
I will see you there next year. I'm looking forward to it, and I'm looking forward to your boot camp. All your links will be down in the show notes below. I can't say enough about your Rule Classroom. That is really awesome, especially the recent one on Franco, Nevada. I saw it, and then when I saw the, you and Adrian talking about it, I'm like, okay, I'm not crazy here. This is great.
By the way, thank you for your personal participation in the classroom discussions. Those question and answer sessions are poorly attended now. There's only about 150 people there. So I'm delighted that you're forward-thinking enough to participate yourself in those discussions.
Well, thank you. And thank you for doing it. It's quite a service, and I'm surprised it's not more popular. I'd highly recommend it. There's going to be 15,000 people that see this, and I would recommend all of you to go there. There'll be a link, and there's even an app on your phone where you can literally get it right on your phone in real time and type in questions or even share screen and ask you directly like we are now.
It's interesting to me that earlier this week I was on BNN across Canada doing question and answers for 80,000 people. It says something about the power of the Bloomberg network relative to the Rule network. When I'm on my own network, I command a 150-person audience. And when I go on Bloomberg's network, I command an 80,000-person audience. So it'll keep me humble, Steve.
Yeah, maybe that had something to do with the Franco-Nevada bump real quick right after that. I bet it did. All right, well, thank you very much, Mr. Rule, and thank you for tuning in. We hope to see you at the next boot camp. Support the show and use the link below. Also, hit the like and subscribe and share this with anyone that you think needs to hear it. It's probably your buddy that can't stop talking about tech stocks. You have yourself a great rest of the day, and we will talk to you next time.